So, from what I gather, from what I understand, but then you saw them, they're not really, they don't really care about it.
My name is Ted Baird. I'm the treasurer of the Francis Dorrance Chapter, the Society for Pennsylvania Archaeology. We have meetings every on the last Tuesday of every month, except for the summer months, at the Duryea Borough Building. And this month's presentation was on the finding of the Shawnee Minisink site, which is a Paleo-Indian site found down around the Delaware Water Gap. Our speaker was Rich Poirier, and I hope you enjoy it.
I'd just like to introduce Rich
Poirier.
Poirier, okay. Hey, I would have had it right if I'd trusted myself.
Yeah.
Okay.
You did well. How you doing? You guys mostly remember me. I did the Flint Napin event here. My name is Richard Poirier. By far, I am not a professional archaeologist, but like some of you, I started looking for Indian artifacts when I was 11, 12 years old. Got the bug and really wanted to find out what these Indian artifacts were, who made them, how old they were, you know, the whole thing. So what I did is looked in the libraries for books on Native Americans and their artifacts. And as time progressed, I got to be friends with Don Klein, who happens to be the discoverer of the most famous paleo site in basically east of the Mississippi at one time. Now there's others. But this site that he discovered in 1972 is very important in that it is stratified, it's layered just like a cake, you know, your cake, your icing on the top, and if you would think as topsoil as being the icing, a layer of cake, and then some filling, maybe a woodland component, another, you know, cake area, which would be maybe sand, which separated the woodland from the late archaic, from the middle archaic to the early archaic. So I will get into that in a little bit. I just want to say that I've been doing this for nearly 47 years. I was the president of ICANE, Indian Artifact Collectors Association of the Northeast. Most of us are amateur. And we're out there in the field, looking up the creeks, looking in the fields. And when we do find something of importance, we bring it up to people like Al. We bring it up to people like Mike Stewart, Kirk Carr. And if they feel it's important enough to organize a dig, then they, you know, set up and get funding from different universities or National Geographic, which that's what happened with Don Klein. And I'm going to start there. In 1972, Don had dug all over the Portland, Delaware Water Gap area. And basically what he was finding was, you know, woodland to early archaic. Once he got a couple feet down, he ran into sterile soil and just went on to the next dig or, you know, adventure. When he got to the Shawnee Minisink site, which originally was the DiRocco site. The owners were the DiRoccos when he got permission to do some excavating there on the site. And if you can see that, the Delaware River is here. Delaware Water Gap would be in this area. This is an island. I think it's Depew Island, right, Russ? Russ also is my right-hand man tonight. He's going to say yes or no, and he's going to help me along. He's a good friend of mine. He's been involved with archaeology, I'm going to say most of his life, and he's taken great pictures of and was on the Shawnee Minisink site, you know, all through the years that it was happening, and probably helped to excavate too. We just didn't happen to be there at the same time. But the Shawnee Minisink site, here's the Broadhead Creek, is actually at the confluence of the Delaware and the Broadhead Creek on the second terrace, Russ, I believe, which would have made it roughly 50 to 60 feet above the river level. So what Don did is he got permission from the DiRoccos. The land was sold. and now became the owners of Shawnee, Shawnee Property at the time, or Hope, Carl Hope, which owned Shawnee, I believe, or at least the ski area. So originally, the Shawnee Menacing site was the DeRocco site, and then the land got sold again, and there was a little bit of a question on how they should name the site. So they named it after two towns, of which the site is in between. Shawnee on the Delaware is upriver, and Menacing is just to the east of the site. So they named the site the Shawnee Menacing site, which, of course, Menacing is actually an Indian name, Mincing, which happens to be an Indian tribe from the Lenapes that used to live in the area. They got displaced back when white man started coming up. The Shawnee moved in and settled in the area, Indians, and they got displaced. And so the two town names are named after the Native Americans that live in that area.
Until 1995, there were no pulmonary hypertension treatments available. Today, there are 12 medicines for adults, but none have been approved for children with PH. That's why PHA is committed to funding groundbreaking pediatric research. Visit phassociation.org to help provide hope for children with PH. Hope for Ian, Katie Grace, Maddie, and me, Lucas. The Pulmonary Hypertension Association, empowered by hope. You may say I'm a dreamer,
but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will be one. Imagine no possessions.
Diagnosed with breast cancer, both of my daughters were pregnant, and everything I was looking forward to turned into everything I was going to miss. First words, first steps, being there for my grandchildren, for my daughters. Today, those babies are three. I'm with them all the time. I don't know what's next, but I know I'm here today. My name is Alanthea Pena, and I'm Susan G. Komen.
Help save lives.
Gift giving is hard.
Gift giving is an art.
What do you give the person who's got everything?
I gave her a heifer.
You're giving me a cow for my birthday?
It's a farm animal.
It's more than a gift.
A farm animal helps families in hunger.
Gifts like this change lives.
Give different. Christmas, Valentine's Day, Hanukkah, whatever you want.
Give a family life.
It's more than a gift.
It's the best gift I ever gave.
Get out to the forest.
Let the kids connect to their roots. It's gonna be so much fun.
Yeah!
Woo-hoo!
Hey, guys, wait up!
And discover the wonders of nature with your family.
These trees are the key to our way of life.
Fresh air.
What a glorious
clean water, and endless forest adventure.
Yeah! Let's rock this jungle!
Yo, this is untapped territory.
How amazing!
Visit discovertheforest.org to find a forest near you.
Hi, I'm Ben Affleck. The only thing better than playing a hero in the movies is being a hero in real life. Like the 50,000 veterans who returned from Iraq and Afghanistan with devastating injuries. They are true heroes, and they're why I'm proud to support Paralyzed Veterans of America. For more than 60 years, Paralyzed Veterans of America has made a promise to never leave a fallen comrade behind. They make sure veterans with spinal cord injuries get the quality medical care, rehabilitation, and housing they need when they come home. They stay with our fallen heroes for the long term, offering counseling, job training, and support to help them regain the freedom and independence they fought so hard for, all at no cost to them. Our veterans fought for us. Let's fight for them. To learn more about how you can help, visit pva.org. That's pva.org. We will never leave a fallen comrade behind.
As I said before, the site was first excavated in 1972. Don, as he was used to, dug down 3-4 feet. And he found some woodland, some late archaic, and middle archaic. And then he hit sterile ground. So he figured, well, that's probably the end of it. So he opened up another square next to that, dug that one down 4 or 5 feet, hit that same sterile ground, gave up, and kind of went home and was, you know, researching. And he had found that up on the upper Delaware, there was some archaeologists digging, and they went down to 12 feet, and they encountered some paleo material at a greater depth. So he thought, you know, I should have went down till I hit maybe river gravel, or was certain that there was no other component down below. So he went back the following year, 1973, opened up another square, and this time he took it down to beyond 8 feet. At the 8 feet level, he encountered flakes. And he knew that he had found early archaic material 3 feet above that. So now he was wondering, what am I discovering here? An earlier archaic component, or was it possibly paleo? With just the flaking, he couldn't tell. But as he expanded his excavation, he found a typical paleo end scraper. I believe in that one square, he found 2 or 3 paleo end scrapers. Of course, he was thrilled, you know, but, and there was a lot of work to be done. He had to shore up the sides of the excavation, being he was at the 8 foot level. When he finally, you know, made sure that Ann also got information from and input from other local archaeologists that he had possibly hit a paleo seal paleo component. He shore up the sides and got involved with Charles McNett at University of Virginia. Am I correct on that? American University. Yeah, I have some notes, but I'm trying to muddle through it just from remembering. But he became very interested in that. It was a seal component, and every other component, early archaic, woodland, you know, was also buried and by itself. So the university gathered their troops, and they opened up an excavation, I believe, in 1974, that following year. They opened up a great big area, probably about the size of this room. And with everybody's help and the university, they dug it down to the paleo level, which took some time because they didn't want to disturb any of the upper components. So they had to dig down to every, you know, woodland, archaic. They couldn't just strip the soil and lose the information from those later occupations. So they did some digging down. When they did excavate everything, there was thousands of flakings. They found hundreds of end scrapers, side scrapers, other tools. And I'm just going to check my notes here on when the first fluted point was found. I believe, let me see if I have it written down here. In I should have wrote that down. Well, anyway, they came up with a fluted point, which, you know, it's kind of calling card. Yeah, we're into a paleo level. Yes, we are at the Clovis area. Also, they found a hearth with charcoal. They were able to get some radiocarbon dating done with the help of Mike Stewart from Temple University and other archaeologists. And also, they got grants from National Geographic, I believe, in the beginning. And then they had grants from other university to keep going. So they had hearth, they had Clovis points, they had a sealed paleo component. Now everybody was really glad that this happened. Don Klein also is an amateur archaeologist that, to my knowledge, he was affiliated with Chapter 14, Forks of the Delaware, down in the Easton area. He had done digging with them and then also dug on his own. That's how he came up and discovered this site. Through the years, a number of archaeologists, probably a lot of the archaeologists from the Northeast have been to the site. Geologists, people studying, you know, the geology of the ground and everything else. Now I have to refer to my note and see if I missed anything along the way here. I got to know about the site. I should tell you my involvement with it. Because I was friends with Don, when the university began to dig, Don said, come on up. We're opening up, you know, a great big area, and this should be, you know, really interesting. So I went up there and I watched them. I carried a few buckets of dirt, which I did for Al here. Maybe two buckets I carried. I get so involved, you know, and checking out what everything is going on that I wasn't much help. But and I talk a lot, right, Al? So I kept everybody, you know, informed of what was going on. Anyway, I was there numerous times. I helped a little, and then I went and visited where at the university, Strasbourg University, where they would go through the artifacts, clean them and label them and, you know, put tags on them. So I was there and saw a lot of the artifacts that was gathered. I believe to this point, which the last excavation was 2008, I believe, they were well over 55,000 artifacts. Of course, not all tools, artifacts meaning flakes, debris, debattage, and whatnot. In the hearth itself, when they analyzed and did flotation, they found plum seeds, fish bones. I believe they even had caribou involved into some of what was in the charcoal. That was pretty unique for the eastern United States, being it was sealed and in the hearth that they had found multiple fish and caribou. You know, at one time, these paleo Indians were renowned to be big game hunters, meaning mammoths, mastodon, you know, elk, caribou, those types of things. But if you're a woodsman, you know, if you're out in the woods and you happen to get a deer, that's great, but you gotta live outside of, you know, getting a deer, and nuts and fruits and fish and berries would be included into your diet. And I'm sure that these people did all that. But without proof, you only speculate. And Shawnee Minnesink was the proof of, you know, the Clovis people having a diverse diet of the time. We're gonna shoot through some, yeah, please. And this is, actually, I looked at these slides a long time ago when Don first gave them to me, and then I put them away, so now I'm revisiting all these slides, and if we just go through the slides a little bit.
Let me just see if I can, no, I can't turn that sideways.
Okay, yes.
One thing you might mention was the closeness of the quarry.
Okay, you know, speculation on why, then now you get into why were these Clovis people actually settled in this spot. First of all, they had great access to water, fresh water with the Broadhead, the Delaware for fishing, and also there is the Zimmerman Flint Quarry, which is just to the, I think, west, northwest of the site, probably within a quarter of a mile. And they actually did some research on the site, and they found hammer stones, biface, broken bifaces, which, you know, can't positively assign to those Indians, but that flint was definitely used to make a lot of their tools. So they had direct source of tool material, the Delaware for food, and also fresh water from the Brawhead Creek coming down through. So you have all, it's perfect scenario for that type of a site.
I don't like to go to school hungry.
I'm embarrassed that I don't have my lunch.
I get tired when I don't eat.
Hunger is unkind.
Hunger is unfair.
Hunger is uncool.
Hunger is everyone's problem.
Hunger is unloving.
Uncaring.
Unacceptable.
Unimaginable.
Hunger is you.
Hunger is me.
Hunger is all of us.
Help undo hunger for America's children. Go to hungeris.org.
Together, we can make a difference.
When you live a busy life like I do, every moment counts.
When I was diagnosed with asthma, I was afraid my career might skip a beat. Nearly 25 million Americans suffer from asthma. We're not alone.
Great session, Kristen.
Thank you. That's why I count on my rescue inhaler with a dose counter. It keeps track of the number of doses I have left, so I can count on my asthma medication when I need it the most. Keep your own count. Visit knowyourcount.com to learn more.
You're out there. There's no telling what you'll find.
I see it, I see it.
Oh, look at you.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org.
I'm not sure I want to invent the supercomputer, but I definitely want to build the supercomputer.
I want to be an inspiration.
An organizer of like do-gooders.
I want to be a veterinarian. I want to help out animals and work with them.
A media mogul. Just rule the world.
When I'm older, I want to be anything but the one that doesn't fit in, the one that people don't love.
Everyone deserves a dream.
Everyone.
But some of us feel depressed, anxious, angry, and do things that others think aren't normal.
We can't even focus on the present, much less the future.
If that's you, say something.
It's okay to talk. It's okay to share. It's okay to get help or help someone.
Talk to someone. It helps. And people will listen. Add your voice at okaytotalk.org.
I've got a job to do today.
Don't forget, you've got a job to do today.
Hey, Mom. I got the job. Thanks.
I've got the job. Welcome aboard.
donations to Goodwill fund job training programs right in your community.
Feels good to start fresh, right?
Sure does.
And like that, you're a job creator.
Cancer will strike more than 175,000 kids worldwide this year alone. The likelihood that teens and young adults will survive cancer is far greater when treated by pediatric oncologists. Survival can depend on experts in childhood cancer and collaborative groundbreaking research. To learn how you can help keep these kids in play, go to stbaldrick's.org/inplay or standuptocancer.org/pediatrics.
The site was written on by Charles McNatt. And the book can be purchased if you know, you go on the site to, I don't know what website you would go on to, but research into Paleo Indians. And this is basically research from 1974 to 1977 or 78, I believe. It has a lot of pictures of the artifacts. It is written by an archaeologist, so it gets into a lot of technical aspects. And would be, you know, if you're interested in the site, that is one of the books, and the only book, I think, to be written solely on the Shawnee Minnesink site. Although bits and pieces have been written about the site in numerous publications. One is the Mammoth Trumpet. Mammoth Trumpet is like a magazine. At first, it was just a leaflet that kept you updated on whatever new research was done on the Clovis era. That is the article that you have. It basically gives you from the beginning to what was happening towards the end of the excavation, and everybody has a copy of that for yourself. Let's flip through some of these, and then I'll try to explain some. At the same time, I left you hanging back in 74, 75 when I helped with the site. I stayed away from there for quite a while the archaeologists were doing their thing. But after they left in 1977, Don did have permission to expand his excavations there. And he again went back and put down 10-foot squares at different times. And the last time that he dug there in 2008,